Okay, Duke Ellington. I hope everybody first looked at the links to YouTube videos of Duke Ellington and his band. You can see he's elegant, handsome, sophisticated person, right? Playing the piano and everybody's dancing, and he plays the piano as if it's just so easy, right? And Duke Ellington, like Louis Armstrong, is one of the great jazz musicians. He's just able to take jazz and turn it into very, very sophisticated music. The music of Louis Armstrong and early jazz musicians is really important because it kind of broke the old style of music, and it created this new form of music. But Duke Ellington really took that new form of music and turned it into a lush, beautiful, really sophisticated compositions. And Duke Ellington is famous for his bands. He was almost instantly famous when he was young. He was a painter. He studied art. And I guess art was not enough for him. It was too quiet. He needed to express himself more fully and more completely. He was a middle-class kid who went to school and grew up in a pretty comfortable home. But he became probably the greatest band leader ever. He was born 1899 and he lived until 1974. When I was young, I got to see him, which was really a magnificent experience. And seeing him was just so impressive. And the band was huge, and not huge, but 16-piece, which is the usual size of jazz band. And it was just, I can still remember clearly, I was very young, just 10 or 11, and it was just a spectacular experience. The bands that he led were really wonderful bands. They were able to play exactly what he wrote. And his style of jazz is a little different from other people. He has less improvisation. The improvisation is very short, very compact. Instead of that, he has really complicated compositions. And Duke Ellington wrote down everything. So his style of jazz is not just playing, it's reading the music and playing. So he led bands in Harlem. He was a most important band leader in Harlem in the 1920s and 1930s. He also left Harlem and went to the white areas of New York to play in many clubs downtown. Harlem is uptown. He also went downtown. And his bands were famous for being able to basically play everything. Duke Ellington wrote almost 2,000 works in his lifetime. And it's just hard to imagine, right? 2,000, not just songs, but he also wrote symphonies, right? Taking the idea of classical music, he would write jazz symphonies. So the songs are connected, and he wrote operas where all of the songs and all of the singers and the musicians are performing in jazz style a kind of opera, just like from Italy or Germany. He wanted to make an American-style opera, American-style symphonies, which connected to classical music, but had a different rhythm and a different feeling in the music, and of course a different kind of structure based on the blues and including jazz. He wrote slow love songs, ballads. He wrote fast dance songs, that everybody would just, you instantly get up and dance. He wrote complicated pieces for jazz musicians. He wrote symphonies. His range of musical talent is really never been equaled. He was also a magnificent band leader. He picked the people in his band very, very carefully, and he wrote the pieces for each of the members of the band. He would write a song thinking of this saxophone player, or this bass player, or this guitarist, this trumpeter. And he had a very, very close connection to his band. And he, of course, made music, made recordings, just playing the piano or playing with a small group. But it was really the big bands that made him famous, and that he really showed his amazing talent. His songs are still played today. They're famous parts. They're famous songs, and they're part of what people learn if they learn jazz. His influence is just almost impossible to imagine. He gave to jazz sophistication. He gave to jazz respect. And by doing that, he gave respect to all black people. Jazz was very much thought of as black music, and it had a kind of African, savage feeling to it in the 1920s and 1930s. And people went to hear jazz because it was exotic, right? The dancers had very little clothing on, and the rhythms were strong and scary. And people loved this. White musicians, or white customers, came to see black musicians, black dancers. And that dynamic is a little strange. People went to the Cotton Club, white people went to the Cotton Club as the customers. Black people did not go to that club. They went to different clubs. And yet Duke Ellington was able to present the music with a great deal of self-respect and a great deal of high self-respect, a pride in the music that really changed people's attitudes about what black music was and what black people were. That's unimaginably big change he made in many, many people's minds. When Harlem Renaissance was going on, really until he died in 1974, Duke Ellington was a huge star. Everybody knew him, and he had a kind of highly successful career. He had the usual problems everybody did, having a big band, with 16 musicians, touring is really difficult, right? It's difficult to tour with five or even one. But for many, many years, even up to the time of rock and roll, when rock and roll took over as the music, he was able to keep this band going and keep himself famous. He was a very thoughtful and very educated person. His symphonies were based on many different things. One of the most beautiful ones is based on Shakespeare. When he went to England, he went to the Globe Theater, and he was deeply influenced by seeing Shakespeare, and he wrote a whole set of songs about Shakespeare. When he went to India and to Africa, he would pick up these tones and sounds and feelings and would put all of this into music. He was a writer. If he didn't write music, of course he might have painted, but he would have written huge novels to express all the feelings and the ideas that he held. Now, it's almost impossible to choose some songs to listen to. He wrote 2,000 songs. All of these songs are well-known songs. People can sing them. But I wanted to choose three of his very early songs that come from the Harlem Renaissance. And we'll listen to three songs. The first one is called The Mooch. The Mooch is somebody who kind of tries to borrow money from you. And so the song, I think, gets the feeling of Harlem nightlife, of how people lived at that time, or some people lived. And the feeling of the nightlife, of being awake all night, right? The shows start maybe at 9 o'clock is the earliest, and 11 o'clock and 1 o'clock, and even now in New York, if you go to the jazz clubs to listen, the earliest set maybe is at 7 o'clock, but jazz clubs stay open till 3, 4, till dawn, and that was definitely the case during the Harlem Renaissance. They stayed open all night. So let's listen to The Mooch. This is a fun song, interesting song, and listen to the connection between all of the different instruments. It's really a marvelous work of art. Thank you. That was the Mooch. Now, I want to play another song which I think gets the feeling of how sophisticated his music is. The second song we'll listen to is called Mood Indigo. Indigo means blue, dark blue dye. Very common in Japan, indigo, indigo clothing, indigo dye, is that kind of rich, rich blue color. And Mood Indigo is a song which I think is very slow, very beautiful. And there's words to this, or words were put to the song much later. But as we listen here, you'll get a sense of how, again, how the band is not trying to be exciting, it's trying to create an entire visual experience that the sound and the whole shape of everything that's happening is very, very well planned, very, very well considered. This is a beautiful song and a really famous song that people, many bands, even now, still play. So let's take a listen. Mood Indigo. Okay, that was Mood Indigo. That's a calm and relaxing song, but of course, I don't want anybody to fall asleep, so let's get a kind of faster dance tune. Duke Ellington's orchestras, as he called them, his bands, big bands, were really dance music. And the last one is called Rockin' in Rhythm. And yes, the word rock came from jazz and blues. This tune is a little different from Mood Indigo. Mood Indigo is beautiful, right? There's colors. You can see the blue as you listen to the music. But Rockin' in Rhythm is a fun song. It's a song which created a kind of rhythm that people could dance to in many, many different patterns, right? The idea of jazz rhythm is that it moves you. It's always kind of moving ahead. And I think that captures the feeling of the Harlem Renaissance, which is a time of great movement, great motion, great change. So as the final song about Duke Ellington, after having looked at him, you can imagine being in the club and seeing him and talking to him and how wonderfully all the band members are dressed and the dancers are gorgeous and everybody's moving, dressed up. This is a great song to get everybody out onto the dance floor. So let's listen to Duke Ellington's Rockin' in Rhythm.
Thank you.